In this video, I'm going to start the KutaSoftware Infinite Geometry Free Worksheet Independent and Dependent Events. You can find this within the Statistics and Probabilities subsection. For numbers 1 through 4, we're to determine whether the scenario involves an independent event or a dependent event. But what exactly is the difference? Well, an independent event is where the outcome of what happens first does not affect the second outcome or the third outcome, and so on. That is what makes an event independent. So for example, if you flip a coin and you get heads, because you got heads the first time does not mean that if you flip it a second time that you won't get heads that second time. Now, a dependent event is where the first outcome does affect the second outcome. So for example, say you have a couple different fruit options, an apple, a banana, and an orange. If you eat the orange on the first day, then you only have the apple and banana left. So you could not possibly eat an orange on the second day. You would have to either eat a banana or an apple. So that would be an example of a dependent event. Let's look at number one and decide whether it's independent or dependent. In number one, you flip a coin and then roll a fair six-sided die. The coin lands on heads and then the die shows a one. This is an example of independent events. Because regardless of what you got, whether you got heads or tails, you could still get a one or any number on that die. Your first outcome does not affect the second outcome. In number two, it says a bag contains 8 red marbles and 4 blue marbles. You randomly pick a marble and then pick a second marble without returning the marble to the bag. The first marble is red and the second marble is blue. So because you picked a red marble the first time and you did not put it back into the bag, now there are only 7 red marbles but still 4 blue marbles. So your chances of picking a blue have gone up. Because that first outcome affected the second outcome, it is indeed a dependent event. And number 3, a box of chocolates contains 5 milk chocolates, 5 dark chocolates, and 5 white chocolates. You randomly select and eat 3 chocolates. The first piece is milk, the second is dark, and the third is white. Is this independent or dependent? Now, picking the first piece, you've taken away an option to get a milk chocolate the next time. So when you go to choose your second piece of chocolate, now there are only 4 milk chocolates left. And when you choose dark chocolate your second time, now there are only 4 dark chocolates left. So you can see, as you choose chocolates, the probability of picking another chocolate increases. So the likelihood that you would get a white chocolate your third time is higher than getting a milk or a dark, since now there are fewer milk and dark chocolates. So number 3, we have dependent events. And lastly, we'll go over number 4. Number 4 says a cooler contains 10 bottles of sports drinks, 4 lemon lime, 3 orange, and 3 fruit punch. 3 times, you randomly grab a bottle and you return that bottle to the cooler and mix the bottles up so that the bottles are still placed randomly in the cooler. The first time, you get a lemon lime drink. But since you return that lemon lime drink back to the cooler, there's still 4 lemon limes. The second and third times, you get fruit punch. So you pick out fruit punch, but you return that fruit punch back so that there's still 3 remaining when you choose a third time. Therefore, because you're putting the sports drinks back, this is an example of independent events. Now, if you did not return the bottle, then it would be dependent, because then your next options or your next choices are affected by what you chose first. In numbers 5 through 8, we're going to find the probability. In number 5, it says you flip a coin and then roll a fair six-sided die. The coin lands heads up and the die shows an even number. Now there's a probability formula that we're going to be able to use for independent events. And that's that the probability of A times the probability of B will equal the probability of A and B. Or the probability of A and B we can write as the probability of A intersection B. Because when you think of a Venn diagram, if we have A and B, the probability that both A and B occur is in that middle section or the intersection of A and B. So whenever you see the probability of A and B, think the probability of A intersection B. So because this is an independent event, we can use this formula. So we're going to do the probability of heads, and we're going to multiply that by the probability that we get an even number on a die. So the probability of heads, you have two choices. You either get heads or tails. So getting heads is one out of the two. Getting an even number is 2, 4, or 6 on a die. So that's 1, 2, 3 possibilities out of the total of 6 numbers on the die. So multiplying the numerators and the denominators together, 1 times 3 is 3, 2 times 6 is 12, that's equal to 3/12. And we can simplify, 3 goes into 3 one time, and 3 goes into 12 four times. And 1/4 in decimal form is 0.25. So the probability that we get heads and the die shows an even number is 1/4. In number 6, it says you roll a fair-sided die twice. The first roll shows a 5, and the second roll shows a 6. So again, we can use the probability of A times the probability of B equals the probability of A and B, or A intersection B, because these are independent events. The first outcome does not affect the second outcome. So the probability that we roll a 5 is 1 out of 6, and we're going to multiply that by the probability that we roll a 6, which is also 1 out of 6. 1 times 1 is 1, 6 times 6 is 36. So 1/36 is equal to 0.028, and that 0.028 is the rounded value. In number 7, there are 8 shirts in your closet, 4 blue and 4 green. You randomly select one to wear on Monday and then a different one on Tuesday. You wear blue shirts both days. So this is not an independent event. This is a dependent event, so we're going to be using a different formula. So the probability of A times the probability of B given A is going to equal the probability of A and B, A intersection B. Now, the probability of B given A is known as a conditional probability. So that's the probability that one event occurs given that an event already happened. So for number 7, randomly select one shirt to wear on Monday, and that shirt was blue. So the probability that it's a blue shirt the first day, if there's 8 shirts total, 4 of them are blue, that's a 4 out of 8 chance that we pick a blue shirt that day. Now, on Tuesday, we also wear a blue shirt. But now, as opposed to there being 8 shirts in our closet, since we already wore one shirt the first day, there's only 7 shirts now. And since we already wore one blue shirt, the chance that we wear a blue shirt again, we have to take away 1 from that 4, just as we took away 1 from the total of shirts. So now, there's only 3 blue shirts in our closet. So it's a 3 out of 7 chance that we wear a blue shirt. So 4/8 on the first day that we get a blue shirt, and 3/7 on the second day that we get a blue shirt. 4 times 3 is 12, 8 times 7 is 56. 4 goes into 12 3 times, and 4 goes into 56 14 times. So 3/14 is our simplified fraction, and when we divide 3 by 14, our rounded number will be approximately 0.214. So that's our probability that we wear a blue shirt both Monday and Tuesday. In number 8, we have a basket that contains 5 apples and 7 peaches. We randomly select one piece of fruit and eat it. Then we randomly select another piece of fruit. So because we ate that fruit, we're not replacing it back into the basket, which means that these are dependent events. So we're going to be using the probability of A times the probability of B given A equal to the probability of A and B. So the probability that we choose an apple will get multiplied to the probability that we choose a peach, given that we already chose an apple. So after an apple is chosen, so the probability that we have a peach after an apple was chosen, or the probability that we get a peach given that an apple was chosen first, that equals the probability that we choose an apple and then choose a peach. The probability that we choose an apple, if there's 5 apples total and 7 peaches, 5 plus 7 equals 12. So the probability that we get an apple is 5 out of 12. Now, since we already chose an apple, there are now only 4 apples remaining, and we have to take away 1 fruit from the total amount of fruits. So now there's only 11. So out of the 11 fruits for our next option, there are still 7 peaches. So we have 7 out of 11 of getting a peach. So multiplying the numerators, we'll get 35 out of multiplying the denominators. 12 times 11 is 132. So if we take 35 and divide that by 132, we'll get approximately 0.265 as the probability of first choosing an apple and then a peach. Now for numbers 9 through 12, we're going to determine if events A and B are independent. And remember, if they are independent, then the probability of A times the probability of B will indeed equal the probability of A and B. So let's look at number 9. The probability of A is 2/5, and we're going to multiply that by the probability of B, which is 1/5. Does that equal the probability of A and B, 2 out of 25, or 2/25? Well, 2/5 times 1/5, multiplying the numerators, 2 times 1 is 2, and 5 times 5 is 25. So 2/25 does indeed equal 2/25. Therefore, in number 9, these events are independent. Does the probability of A times the probability of B equal the probability of A intersection B, or A and B? So we'll have 2/5 times 1/4. Does that equal 1/25? Well, 2/5 times 1/4, 2 times 1 is 2, and 5 times 4 is 20. So 2/20 does not equal 1/25. We could even simplify 2/20 down to be 1/10. And 1/10 does not equal 1/25. Therefore, in number 10, our events are not independent, which makes them dependent. Now in number 11, as opposed to giving us the probability of A and B, they give us the probability of A given B. However, the probability of A given B is equal to the probability of A and B divided by the probability, or over the probability, of B. So if these events are independent, remember, we need to see if probability of A times the probability of B equals the probability of A and B. Is that true? That's what we're looking for. However, currently we can rewrite this conditional formula to have it be the probability of A given B times the probability of B equals the probability of A intersection B, or A and B. And that's because I've simply multiplied both sides by the probability of B. So let's plug in what we know. The probability of A given B is 27 over 50, and the probability of B is 1/2. So that will equal our probability of A intersection B, which is 27 over 100. Because 27 times 1 is 27, and 50 times 2 is 100. Now, let's see if the probability of A times the probability of B, does that equal 27 out of 100, or 27/100. So the probability of A times the probability of B, does that equal the probability of A and B? Well, the probability of A is 9/20. The probability of B is 1/2. Does that equal the probability of A and B, which we calculated to be 27 out of 100? 9 times 1 is 9. 20 times 2 is 40, and 9/40 does not equal 27 out of 100, or 27 one-hundredths. 27 one-hundredths equals 0.27, whereas 9 divided by 40 equals 0.225. Therefore, because the probability of A times the probability of B does not equal the probability of A and B, then the events in number 11 are dependent. So in number 11, our answer is dependent. And lastly, we'll go over number 12. We have the probability of not A, the probability of B, and the probability of A and B. Remember, if they are independent, then the probability of A times the probability of B will equal the probability of A and B, or A intersection B. But what exactly is not A? Well, there's a formula that says 1 minus the probability of not A is equal to the probability of A. So if we take 1 and subtract not A, 3/4, we'll get the probability of A. So 1 minus 3/4 is 1/4. So if the probability of A equals 1/4, we'll take that probability of A, multiply it by the probability of B, and does it equal the probability of A and B? Probability of A, 1/4, times the probability of B, 3/10. Does that equal 3/40? 1 times 3 is 3, 4 times 10 is 40, 3/40 does indeed equal 3/40. Therefore, in number 12, our events are independent. And I'll go ahead and stop this video here. Join me in the next video where I'll finish out this worksheet completing numbers 13 through 22. And if you haven't already, click that like button, subscribe to my channel, and share this video with your classmates.